Thank you. fullness of your grace.
In the fullness of your grace. In the power of your name. You lift me up. You lift me up.
And we just want to give God all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise for a life well lived, for a life full of love, a life full of strength that she passed on to us. And we wanted to open up with that song just to remind you, family, that God is a very present help in the time of trouble. He is your strength. God never promised you that you'll get over her passing, but God did promise that he will get you through it. But before we could grieve too hard, the Bible says the Lord gives, the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. So can we just bless God right here, right now, for the life of our dear sister, Lorene Smith. He's worthy of all of that praise. On the one side, there's grief, but on heaven's side, there's joy. God says that blessed are the dead that die in the Lord. And when you're in the Lord, although death hurts on this side, it is a glorious accepting and a reception on heaven's side. Because right now, she is in the very presence of the Lord. Amen. Yeah, that's good. One of the things I love about preaching the funeral of a Christian, I don't have to lie. And if I did lie, y'all would know it. So everything I'm going to say and everything that's going to be said about Sister Lorene Smith, you all know it's the whole truth and nothing but the truth. We're going to follow the program as printed. Reverend James Gentry, Associate Minister here at New Morning Star, followed by prayer by our own Reverend Collis B. Smith, Jr. These are the men she heard preached and taught and prayed and all over the place, just ministered to her in so many ways. And then after that, we'll have the New Morning Star praise team with another number.
Scripture reading is coming from Romans 8, 34 through 39. And it reads, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or the sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor heights, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God. in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, God, we honor you in this place. God, we thank you, Lord, for Sister Smith's life, God. We thank you for her love. We thank you for her legacy, God. God, we thank you for her laughter, her compassion. God, we pray even now in your matchless name, Christ, that you will begin right now to undergird this family. God, that you will lift them up. God, that you will walk through them, with them through their time of grief. God, we celebrate you for who you are, God. We celebrate you, God, because you chose her to be your daughter. We celebrate you, God, that you saved her, God, and you redeemed her, God, and now she stands with you. God, we bless you in this place, God, because in all things you told us to give you praise and give you thanks. So even in our hurt, we thank you. Even in our pain, we thank you. With tears in our eyes and heads bowed, we utter thank you, God, because you're still good. Now, God, we pray that you'll be glorified, you'll be magnified, you'll be highly exalted throughout this home-going celebration. We bless the matchless name of Jesus, for there's no other name given unto men by which we must be saved. Save someone today, God, through your preached word. We thank you, we exalt you, and we give your name the praise. In Jesus' matchless name, can the redeemed of the Lord say amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. Hallelujah. We just want to encourage the family on this morning that you may have questions, and that's okay to have questions for the Lord, and you just may not understand, but we want to encourage you to trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding. Amen. So we just want to encourage you to trust in God. Never doubt he's going to see you through the days, the weeks, the months, the years to come. He's going to be your strength. So trust in God. Hallelujah.
Together this way. I know y'all trust the Lord. Come on now. Trust.
Trust in God.
Yeah.
Never doubt.
Just believe.
Just believe. He'll work it out.
Trust
in God.
Yeah, yeah.
Never doubt. Just
everybody goes through some hard times. Try to find a way out, some peace of mind. God never said his way would be easy, but he told us he will always be with it. If you trust,
trust in God,
never doubt,
never doubt,
just believe,
just believe,
that I know. Never doubt,
never doubt,
just believe, yeah,
just believe, he'll work it out.
So you say that your problems are too hard to bear, and you feel that the Lord doesn't even care. Just remember that his word is true. Everything he promised, I guarantee he'll do for you if you trust.
Trust in God.
Never doubt.
Never doubt.
Just believe.
Just believe.
Till I know.
Till
I know.
Trust in God.
Never doubt.
Never doubt.
Just believe. Yeah.
Just believe.
Oh, oh. Though it's cloudy.
Though it's cloudy.
And you can't see.
See your way.
The Lord promises he will make a way.
Never
scared.
Trust in God.
Yeah, yeah.
Never doubt.
Just believe.
Just believe.
Say that I know.
Say
that I know.
Trust in God.
Never doubt.
Never doubt.
Just believe.
Just believe.
Oh, oh, though it's cloudy. know he'll see you through if you trust him.
Trust him.
I know he'll make a way. Trust him.
Trust him.
I know he'll see you through if you trust him.
Trust him.
Just trust him.
Trust him.
He'll work it out.
He'll work it out.
I know without a doubt they will work
it out. Work it out.
He'll open up that door. Said he'll work
he'll
it out.
Work it out.
I know he'll make a way.
He'll work it out.
He'll work it out. If you trust him,
trust
him. He'll work it out.
He'll work it out.
If you trust him,
trust him.
He'll work it out.
Yeah,
if you trust him,
trust
him. He'll work it out.
He'll work it out.
If you trust him,
trust
him. He'll work it out.
He'll work it out.
If you trust him,
trust
him. He'll work it out.
He'll work it out.
If you trust him,
trust
him. He'll work it out.
He'll work it out.
All your problems,
trust
him. He'll work it out.
He'll work it out.
All your troubles.
How many of y'all believe that today? God has worked out some things for you in the past, and you know he's going to do it in the present, and he can do it in the future, because that's the kind of God that he is. He's a working it out kind of God. While you trying to figure it out, God done already worked it out. Hallelujah. Bless his holy name. Amen. We've come to the part in our service. The family asks those of you all who have resolutions and cards and acknowledgments if you would forward them to a family member, and it will be read at a later date. At this time, we're going to have the obituary reading by Tania Smith, if you would come here, sweetheart. And then afterwards, we will have a solo by Deborah Towner, which is the sister-in-law, and you can come up here as well. Let's hear from Tania now.
The legacy and life of Lorene Holman. Lorene Smith. Lorene Holman was born on November 28, 1946 in Brent, Alabama, to the proud parents of Lottie Cash and Angelo Holman. She was the oldest of eight siblings. Lorene, affectionately called Sugarfoot, Lo, and Sugar Lorene, confessed her hope in Christ at an early age and joined the Holy Trinity M.B. Church under the leadership of the late pastor Matthew Pettis, Jr. She later joined the New Morning Star M.B. Church under the ministry of Pastor DeWayne Davis, Sr. She worshiped there until her passing. Lorene attended Grant Elementary and McKinley Upper Grade Center. She also attended Malcolm X College, where she received her high school diploma and CNA certificate. She worked various jobs, but the one she loved the most was working as a CNA at the Jackson Square Nursing Facility. She loved giving gifts and taking care of the residents. She worked there for 18 years until her retirement. Lorene was united in holy matrimony to Robert Rankin Alexander Smith, Jr. on January 15, 1963. Lorene made her heavenly transition on Tuesday, August 20, 2024 at 4:30 p.m. at West Suburban Hospital. Lorene was preceded in death by her parents, three sons, Michael, Walter, and Robert Jr., three sisters, Doris Cash, Elaine Holman, and Patricia Holman, and only brother, Clyde Holman. Lorene leaves to cherish her precious memories, two daughters, Loretta Alexander and Aisha Smith, three sisters, Mary, Vera, and Annette, one sister-in-law, Mary, 18 grandchildren, 11 great-grandchildren, and a host of niece, nephews, and other family and friends.
Not a second or another minute, not an hour of another day. But at this moment, with my arms outstretched, Lord, I need you to make a way, as you have done so many times before. Through a window or an open door, I stretch my hands to thee. Come rescue me, I need you right away. I need you now, I need you now, I need you. Not another second, not another minute, not an hour or another day, but Lord, I need you right away. If I've never needed you before, to show up and restore all of the faith that I let slip while I was yet searching the world for more, the truest friend I have indeed. You're my best friend, I know in need. I stretch my hands to thee. Come rescue me, I need you right away. The agony of being alone, the fear of doing things on my own, the tests and trials that come to make me strong, the feelings of guilt, hurt, shame, and defeat. The ways of trials that beat up on me. But to know, Lord, that in you I've got victory. Yeah, yeah. I need you now, Lord. I need you now. Oh, oh, oh. I need you right now, right now, right now. I need you now. Oh, not another second, not another minute, Lord. Can't wait another day. Oh, oh Lord, please make a way. Oh Lord, oh Lord.
Sometimes people don't understand. Family, they expect you to be strong. And God says, in your weakness, my strength is made perfect. Don't let anybody ever tell you it's going to be all right. It ain't going to ever be all right. The only way it can be all right is if God brought her back. We know we don't have any negotiating powers on that one. But we do know that God said, as a comforter, he will come alongside of us And he will walk with us and give us the strength today, right now, and tomorrow. He knows how you feel. The Bible says in Psalm 139, he is intimately acquainted with the things that you are going through. When you hurt, he hurts. When you grieve, he grieves. When you're in sorrow, his heart is heavy. The psalmist put it this way: hear my cry, O God, and attend unto my prayer. From the ends of the earth do I call unto you. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. And so this morning, we just want to take out this moment, and as she prayed that prayer song, be reminded that we all need him right now. Before I bring my elder in the ministry, you see there on the program, we have remarks 2 minutes each. I'm going to yield the floor to about three people that would like to make remarks. 2 minutes. You can come and share how she's touched you. Memorable things that you'll never forget. How because of your life, her life, your life has been forever changed.
Hello, I'm Barbara. My family know I'm the one I always get up anyway. But I noticed over the years that when we at hospitals and we watching our loved ones get sick, Lorene always be the one to tell the doctor. She don't listen to them. Her answer is no. She always be like, my God, my Lord. You know, that was her. She never believed in what doctors said. She believed in what she knew God said. Right now, I got a testimony. And over the past months, I lost my mama. And after I lost my mama, I went to sleep. I dreamed I lost my daughter and my grandson, and she was pregnant. After that, I was in a tragic car accident. This all happened between the time my mama left this world. I couldn't grieve, because I had to stay strong. My daughter went into labor the next day after my mama. We was in a car accident 2 weeks after. And I'm telling y'all today, family, who are stronger, who are together, forget about all what, who did what, who said what. Because when them ambulances took me, I didn't think I had the strength no more. I broke the biggest bone in my body. The doctors told me my healing process was a year. Right now, this 5 months. They told me when I left that hospital, I couldn't walk. I couldn't do nothing for myself. This only 5 months, and look at me. Because you know what? God favored me. He favored me, because what happened to me, I was mad at the world. I was mad at my pastor. I was mad at everybody, and God set me down and he said, you know what? I knew this plan before you even got here. He told me, he said, you know what? Who I wanted there was there. So I'm no longer mad at anyone. Because you feel like people should be there, but they not gonna be there. But what I'm trying to get y'all to understand, y'all probably just wondering, well, what this got to do with this? It got a lot to do with it. Because I understand now. I understand why God does what he does. I understand why he took my mama. My mama is no longer suffering. I understand that there is a cycle of life. There is a plan. And you got to understand that one day we're going to see them again. We gonna see them again, but I thank God for what I went through over these past months, because it made me understand. But don't want to have to let God take somebody, because he does it. He'll take somebody in place of you being not doing what he wants you to do. And it be good people. But I'm glad I could stand here today. I'm glad I could walk. I still got a little limp, but God gonna limp it on out. And I'm going to be all right, because I'm telling you, my process was a year. This is 5 months of me right here now. I can walk. I can do for myself. Ain't nothing like doing for yourself. But I want y'all to just stay prayed up and pull tightly together. You know, because when you can't do it, you can't do it without him.
I come here by way of my pastor, Maddie Johnson, junior pastor, Pastor McFadden. I stand here because I'm an unadopted son. Because of her children, Michael and Walter, she's my mother because she was their mother. My sisters, my brother, and all my extended families from the Smith and the Holmes family, I extend my love and prayer all to you. I do have a journey that God has put me on, and I stand here because of God's glory and love. And I know what it is to be in this situation, and I know what it is to be in that situation out there, to grieve and mourn and celebrate. But I just want to say that when this moment is over, there'll be many more moments to come. And I know one thing about Mother Smith, because that's how I know her, is that she loved the Lord. She kept her house in order.
Yeah.
And no matter what we did as children, we stayed attentive to the way that she ran our house according to her word. And me being here, I just want to pay homage to that, because when I was young, I didn't understand the totality of what she carried. And today I can say that I'm now a witness.
Amen. Good morning, everybody. I feel I'm a homie. I don't know about nobody else. I know the whole family. Okay. My heart deeply goes out to Retta. Okay. To Isha. Rest Duke. Walter and Michael. Okay. I had to come and show that the Dotson family loved the Homie family. We were family for real. Wasn't no joke about it. We was family, especially Lane. I just wanted to let y'all know, ask God for peace, overwhelming peace. Peace within and peace without. I lost my son to murder this year. And I know if God sustaining me, he'll do it for y'all. Okay, have a good one.
Let me ask a question. This is a homegoing service, amen?
Amen.
Come on, I'm going to try it again. I said, this is a homegoing service, amen?
Yeah.
Can somebody stand up? This is a homegoing service. Can y'all just stand up for a minute? Come on, let's set the atmosphere. This is a homegoing service. She made it over, amen? Hallelujah. Give it what's due to her, amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You may be seated.
Hallelujah.
I couldn't find everything to write down, so I wrote down in my notes that I know it would touch somebody's heart. Well, let me just say this before I read this. I watched her as a kid when I used to hang with y'all Brother Slow, and we used to hang on the corner. But I'm going to tell you something. She let her light shine.
Mm-hmm.
And I want y'all to think about that. Even though we was doing all the things she was doing, she never criticized. I'm sure that she went in her prayer closet and prayed. That's why I'm here today. Let me just read this in my notes. Miss Smith always let her light shine. I remember when I was a youth, I never heard her curse. I never heard her drink. That's not normal. Am I talking straight, Pastor? That's not normal. She never said a foul word. I never seen her party. She was a true example for the neighborhood. She displayed Christ at all times. She was kind, and she was a sweet person. Paul tells us in the Corinthians, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Did y'all know what I just said? To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. That means when she left this earth, she just transitioned over. So if you understood that scripture that I just read, you'll give God just a little praise right there. This just a shell, Pastor. This just a shell. And we all have a shell, but we all have to cross over. She made it. She made it. Somebody say she made it. Hallelujah. And that was a place of praise. Let me read this last thing. Miss Smith understood this Bible verse in Philippians chapter 3 and verse 20. It reads, our citizenship is in heaven and not of this earth. She knows she was just passing through. She had a passport a long time ago, preacher. So she knew where her citizenship stood. Hallelujah. I didn't come to preach, but let me read this and I'm done. I'm out your way. Miss Smith, thank you for the light that you shined when I was a kid. This is a homegoing service. Miss Smith made it home.
I shall wear a crown. I shall wear a crown. I
Y'all can keep clapping. As soon as I get home, Elder Powell, you had it right. We are on our way somewhere. And for those of us who know Jesus, we know exactly where that place is. Mama done made it home already. Can't y'all just see her with her white robe on, telling everybody how she made it over? Mama probably saying, the doctor said this, but I made it over. Things were breaking out on earth, but I made it over. I had some hard times in life, but I made it over. I'm here today because Jesus died on the cross, and I made it over the bondage of sin into a life of freedom in Christ Jesus. To my fellow laborers in the gospel ministry, God bless you. Thank you so much for coming alongside of this family in your support and paying respects to them during this time of grief. We've all heard and read firsthand about the beautiful life that Lorene Smith lived. And I want to just say this one word. This young lady has on a t-shirt here that says, don't forget to live. Not exist. Because some folks just get up every day, it's the same old, they're not going anywhere, they're just waiting to die. I want to remind y'all, Mom lived a full life, so don't forget to live. Enjoy yourself while you have the breath in your body. The beautiful life she lived, as I heard them talk about her children, it was quite evident that she was a remarkable woman of character. Why? Because she was saved. She was a woman of principle. Why? Because she was solid. She was a woman of discipline. Why? Because she was serious. She was a woman of love. Why? Because she sacrificed a whole lot. And then she was a woman of commitment because she had staying power. Sister Lorene would come to this church every Sunday. She would serve the Lord. She would worship the Lord. And after I finished preaching, she wasn't a woman of many words. And some of you sisters can learn from that, but she wasn't a woman of many words. But when I preached what I thought was an excellent message, she would just come by the door and she'd do this. So if I'm going to do a good eulogy today, when y'all are on the way out, just do this to me. You said something there. That's what she meant. It's hard to find women of caliber like that these days. As they say, they don't make them like that no more, right? Yeah, but whenever you find one of those kind of women, thank God. And if your mother is one of those kind of women like Lorene Smith, you need to thank God and appreciate that mother. Because they're very, very, very rare. And you only get one. So you better treat her right. As I'm about to deliver this eulogy from the Word of God, Lorene Smith, her life makes it so easy to preach the truth because she lived and believed the truth with all of her heart. She's already preached her funeral and her life, so I'm not going to get into that. But sometimes that's not the case. You know, you go to a funeral and there's somebody in the casket, and like this one lady, she decided to not have an open casket funeral for her husband. And she just wanted to just get it out of the way. So as the preacher was up preaching about her husband, she gets up and moves the flowers aside and began to open up the casket. And the preacher stopped and said, oh, ma'am, I'm so sorry. You wanted to get one last look. I thought you didn't want to view the body. She said, no, I'm not trying to get one last look. I'm trying to see if this is the same person in the casket that you are talking about up there. That wasn't the man I was married to. In the gospel, according to St. John, chapter 14, verse 1 and 3, it reads, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. This morning, I want to eulogize Mama from this title, On the Way to the Father's House. Would you pray with me? Father, thank you so much for the life of this awesome woman of God who is in your presence right now, worshiping and thanking you and telling everybody how she made it over. You have left us without her, but you have not left us without you. So, oh God, we ask for your presence during this time, and that your spirit would speak a word that would uplift our hearts, and that you would continue to comfort this family. It is in your name I pray. Amen. Amen. Jesus, the Son of God, the second person of the Trinity, because God exists in three persons, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. For some of y'all that don't believe that, just go back to Genesis 1. And it says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And then when it came to making man, they said, let us make man in our image. That was God the Father, that was God the Son, and the Holy Spirit. But this same Jesus is the one who came through time and through the womb of a virgin girl named Mary. He came into this world born as a baby without a man, being the Son of God on Christmas morning. Why did he come? Jesus came to live a righteous life, to show us God's love, and to ultimately sacrifice his life on the cross for our sins. He is talking in this text to his disciples, his followers, telling them that he was about to be arrested. He was going to suffer. He was going to be crucified. He was going to be put to death. He was going to be buried. But then he said, 3 days later, I'm going to rise from the dead. Of course, they focused more on the fact that he was going to be taken away from them, and they began to grieve because of the experience of sorrow and the feelings of abandonment. I imagine in the same way many of you have felt sorrow and grief and felt like mama has or sister has or aunt has abandoned you. Well, Jesus is about to tell them four realities about his Father's house, meaning heaven, as he is about to return there. That's why I titled this message, On the Way to the Father's House. Jesus in this text tells us four truths. There is a sweet consolation. There is a great invitation. There's a personal preparation. And then lastly, there's an eternal elevation. Let's look at the consolation part first in verse 1. Jesus says, let not your heart, or do not be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. Jesus knew their hearts were going to be troubled because of his impending death. They were wondering, how are we going to get along without you? Who's going to teach us when you're no longer here? Who's going to perform the miracles that we need? Who's going to instruct us? Who will be there when life presents its overwhelming circumstances to us? So Jesus offers them a sweet consolation. He told them, don't let your hearts be troubled. Now, why would Jesus say, don't let your heart be troubled, when Job already said in Job 14:1, he says, man that is born of a woman is of a few days and full of trouble. Doesn't Jesus understand that trouble is the way of life as we go to the Father's house? I mean, he's telling us not to be troubled. Lord Jesus, why are you telling us not to be troubled? Our economy is collapsing before our eyes. That brings us trouble. There's talk about the company. I might lose my job. That's trouble. The gas prices are so high, I can't even fill my tank up all the way. My tank has trouble. The price of groceries are hitting hard. My pantry and my refrigerator is having trouble. These children of mine are driving me straight crazy. They are bringing me trouble. The doctor keep asking me to come back after more tests, just telling me about trouble. My marriage is so bad, God, I feel like sending the script to a reality TV show because of the trouble that I'm going through in my own marriage, and this presidential race is driving me straight crazy. It brings trouble to my mind. But oh God, oh God, I need you now because my loved one, or loved ones in the case of the lady that came and testified, have passed away. What am I going to do without them? I'm experiencing trouble. People, Jesus understands trouble better than anybody else. But he's telling his disciples and us that we don't have to allow trouble to move our hearts out of place, because if you believe in God, if you trust in God, if you rest in God and Jesus, he said you're going to be able to make it through your troubles. So in other words, when you place your faith and trust in God amid trouble, you can have sweet consolation that everything is going to be all right. A sister, the one that came up here and shared us your testimony, thank you so much, because guess what? That's life, y'all. That is life. Now, those people who tell you by way of prosperity, you're not supposed to experience any trouble, any sickness, any pain, any financial setback, they are lying to you. Welcome to life, y'all. This is life. And Jesus said in John 16:33, in this life you will have tribulation. Now come on, how you gonna speak against what Jesus said? He said in this life you gonna have tribulation, but then he said, but be of good cheer, because I have overcome the world. And if he overcame the world and we are in him, we are more than overcomers. So come what may, even though trouble might come, you can have sweet consolation that God is with me. Folk might not be with you. Folk may leave you. But God says, I will never leave you nor forsake you in your time of trouble. I like this because the psalmist weighs in on this. Listen to what David wrote in Psalm 46, verse 1. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help. Where? In. Come on, y'all. He's a very present help in trouble. He says in Psalm 27, verse 5, for what? In the time of trouble, he shall hide me in his pavilion, in the secret place of his tabernacle. He shall hide me and he shall set me up on a rock. Let me give y'all one more. Psalm 32, verse 7. You are my hiding place. You preserve me, what? From trouble. You will compass me about with songs of deliverance. Although I'm in trouble, I got a song that I'm coming out with, and I'm going to praise God that in my trouble, he provided sweet consolation. Hallelujah. On the way to the Father's house, there's a sweet consolation. But then secondly, there's a great invitation. He says, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. Jesus came to reveal to the world that God loved us so much, despite all the sin that we have done, we can be forgiven, and God has vacancies in heaven, many places that he wants to fill with people that receive him as their Savior. So he sent Jesus from heaven to let earth know that when we die, there are mansions, there are dwelling places waiting for us to occupy. And to back this up, Jesus said, you can count on it, because in the next verse he said, if it were not so, I wouldn't have told you. Jesus never told a lie. The devil lies all the time. And his mama is a liar too, if he had one. Our Lord and Savior don't do bait and switch on us. Y'all ever, you know, you had a coupon, you went to the store, they say buy one, get one free, or buy one meal and get one free, and you go there and they say, well, the free meal is dependent upon the price of the first meal. And like, wait a minute, you said buy one, get one free. Now watch this. It's free, free. Supposed to be, right? So why don't, when they say buy one, get one free, I actually did this, y'all. I went to the grocery store one day. I told the lady, and I had the one item. She said, you know, if you buy one, you get one free. I was like, no, I just want this free one. She said, well, sir, that ain't free. I said, but it says free. Free is free whether I buy one or not. So why not stop lying and just say it's half off? You get half off. Jesus ain't gonna do a bait and switch on us. Like this one man, he was taking care of his sickly mother. Y'all know how there's a lot of drama in the family. Well, y'all don't know about that. Y'all know how like families can have a lot of drama, they ain't talking to each other. And mama was sick and she was on hospice and her oldest son was taking care of her. Family had a lot of drama. Nobody would come over and see after mama. He was the only one. So one day, He picked up the phone. He told his siblings, there were seven of them. He said, you know what? I need y'all to come. Mama is gone. They come from all over the city. They meet in front of the house. They get together, consoling each other. They say, let's go in. So they walk in, and there the son is sitting on the couch. And Mama sitting next to him. Hey, y'all. How y'all doing? What y'all doing over here? It's so good to see all my children together. What y'all doing over here? He said, before they answer, he said, Mama, I knew we ain't got together in a long time, so I told them you died. And so everybody wanted to come see you and pay their last respects. Jesus is not telling us one thing now and going to switch up on us later on. He says, when you get to the Father's house, when you get to the door, you're going to see exactly what I told you. If it were not so, I would not have even opened my mouth. There's lots of room in heaven. For those of y'all who don't know Jesus, there are empty seats in heaven right now that says reserved, but nobody's name is on the reserve sign. He set it aside for you. Why don't you receive Jesus Christ today so he can put your name on that reserve sign? Listen to how he says it in Luke chapter 14, verse 21 through 23. Jesus is telling the disciples, he says, this is God in heaven welcoming everybody on earth. He's given a parable. He says, go out at once into the streets and lanes of the city and bring in here the poor and the crippled and the blind and the lame. And the servant said, Master, what you commanded has been done, and still there is room. And the master said to the servant, go out into the highways and along the hedges and compel them to come. Why? So that my house may be filled. I'm telling y'all, there are spaces for you all who have not come yet. He's set aside and he's compelling you today to come so that his house can be filled. God does not want you to be without him, and he doesn't want to be without you, not for eternity. That's why he sent his son. He loved you so much. He didn't want to live without you, so he died for you so that you may live with him. So this great invitation is extended for those of you who sit here today and you don't know God and the pardon of your sins. Now, just because you have an invitation, that does not automatically mean that you're going there. Jesus brought us the invitation. But before you and I die and can take advantage of that invitation to go to his house, you must invite him into your life. The only way to get into his house, you got to let him get into your heart. That's what the Bible teaches us. The only way to get into his house is to let him get into your heart. That's called salvation. It's called being saved, born again, converted, delivered from your sins, whatever you want to call it. The old saints used to put it like this, Doc. They didn't know a whole lot of theology when they got saved. They didn't know a whole lot of Bible, so they said this. After I gave my life to Jesus, I looked at my hands, and they looked new. I looked at my feet, and they did too. I started walking. I had a new walk. I started talking. I had a new talk. I had joy on the inside that the world didn't give me, and the world can't take it away. I not only had the peace of God, I have peace with God, and so I'm all right now. Unless you receive Christ, you can't go to heaven. Buddha can't get you there. Muhammad can't get you there. Confucius can't get you there. Joseph Smith can't get you there. Let me tell you why. They all die. Go to that grave right now, and they're sitting up in there in a shrine. Their feet going into their grave, and that's it. But oh, go to Jerusalem where the empty tomb is. You'll see some tracks going in, and you'll see some tracks coming out, because 3 days later, Jesus rose from the dead, and he lives forevermore. That's why I trust him. I serve a risen Savior, not a dead teacher. Let me show you what I mean. The scripture says in John chapter 1, verse 12, but as many as received him, to them he gave the right. He gave you the walking papers. He gave you your passport to become the children of God, even to those who believe in his name, who were born, watch this, not of blood, not of or of the will of man, not of the flesh, nor of the will of man. Watch this. But of God. You must be born of God. Now, our belief versus what Jesus talked about. See, many of us believe with our mind. It's like, you believe Michael Jordan got 6 rings? Yeah, I believe that. That's a belief. But trust and believe is a little different. This word believes means to put your whole life on the line, and you ain't playing. You ain't trying. You actually doing it. Let me see if I can illustrate this. There's a tightrope walker that used to walk on a tightrope, and he used to go from one side of the circus to the other side, and everybody would clap. Then one day he decided to go downtown and string a line from one building to the next, and he walked across the tightrope. Then he decided, after he became so good, I'm going to Niagara Falls. I'm going to walk across Niagara Falls. He gets on the rope. He walks all the way across Niagara Falls and back. The crowd went wild. He said, how many of y'all believe that I can do this riding on a bicycle with no rubbers on it, just the rim? They said, we believe you can do it. He got on the bicycle without the rubbers, just the rims. He goes all the way over, turns around, and comes all the way back. Everybody applauded. He said, how many of y'all know that I can do this with a barrel on top of it? They said, we believe. He goes all the way across with this bicycle without tires, with the rim, with a barrel in it, came all the way back. And they applauded him. He said, now, how many of y'all believe that I can put a person in this barrel and go all the way over and come all the way back? A whole lot of people say, I believe, I believe. He said, who wants to be the first one? Nobody got in that barrel. You believe with your mind, but you weren't going to trust him with your life. All I'm saying is, you just can't believe in Jesus with your mind. You got to put your body into it by faith and trust and hope. That's when you get saved. You don't get saved by thinking, by believing, oh, there's a God, there's a man upstairs. I believe in God. I pray to him every night. No, no, no. Are you in the barrel?
All right, all right.
Have you got saved and become part of his church? Listen to what Jesus said in John 3, verse 3 to Nicodemus. Jesus answered and said to him, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see, not even go there. You can't even see the kingdom of God. Now, Jesus said, if it were not so, I wouldn't have told you. Jesus is not lying. Any one of you are out there right now, if you were to die today without Christ, without placing your faith in him, you will not see the kingdom of God. God don't go by good intentions. God knows my heart. Yeah, Jeremiah 17:9 says, the heart is desperately wicked and deceitful. Who can understand it? You can't depend upon your good intentions. You can't even depend on your good works. Well, when I get to heaven, my good, I hope, gonna outweigh my bad. It's amazing we can remember all the good, but for some reason, we kind of have Alzheimer's on the bad. But God ain't got Alzheimer's. He remembers everything we ever done. That's why he provided a Savior for us, so that our sins can be covered. That's why John 3:16, the greatest verse in the Bible, for God so, he so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. You've got the invitation. All you need to do is RSVP. Receive the Savior very personally. Hear me out this morning. Just because Lorene Smith RSVP'd to Jesus for her soul doesn't mean you can use her invitation to get to heaven. I remember marrying a young man in my congregation, and he sent out RSVPs for the reception. They only had 175 places. He sent out all these invitations. On the day of the reception, 250 people showed up. I asked him, I said, how was that possible? He said, Pastor, You know, some of them Negroes went and made copies of the invitation and passed it out around the family to their cousin them that wasn't even invited to the reception. I said, did you let them in? He said, no, I turned them away. I told them, you didn't RSVP. You ain't on the list. You ain't getting in. Go to Burger King, McDonald's, Wendy, White Castle, whatever you want. You can't come up in here because there is no reservation. You're not on the list. Listen, listen to what Pete. Oh, and by the way, y'all remember the old saints used to sing this song, save a seat for me. Save a seat for me. If you make it in glory, save a seat for me. Ain't no seat saving. What do you think this is, a concert hall, a baseball game? This is heaven. You got to have a reservation to go in. Listen to how Peter, the Apostle Peter, put it in 1 Peter 1, verse 3. He said, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to, watch this, y'all, his great mercy has caused us to what? To be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Here's what happens. To obtain an inheritance which is imperishable and undefiled and will not fade away. I love this. Reserved in heaven for you. Amen. So the question on the floor this morning that you must answer before you die, if you were to die tonight, are you 100% sure that you're one of God's children? Some of y'all got that hope so salvation. That don't work. Some of y'all want to get on Lorene Smith's invitation. No, you can't get in on mama's coattail. You can't get in on grandmama's coattail. I remember one day, back in the day, when cell phones started becoming the norm, I remember my sister used to have her cell phone cut off all the time. I never wrote it down in pen. I wrote it in pencil, because I knew it's going to change. So one day, her three-year-old son called me. I saw his name on my caller ID. I'm like, what is my three-year-old nephew doing with a cell phone? I answer, I'm like, hey, nephew, it's my sister. She done cut her cell phone on in her son's name. He 3 years old. All I'm trying to tell you can't cut your salvation on in nobody else's name. If you don't come through Jesus, you get no service. Let me move on. So on the way to the Father's house, there's a sweet consolation. There's a great invitation. But then thirdly, there's a personal preparation. Listen to what Jesus says. I go to prepare a place for you. Let me ask y'all something. I mean, seriously, when you die, do you really have a place to go and you're sure? I mean, you got to think about this. You know, when in the cemetery, there was this, there was this one tombstone where it had emblazoned in there, it said, stop and pause as you pass by. For as you are, so once was I. As I am now, you soon will be. So prepare yourself to follow me. Somebody took a magic marker and wrote under there, to follow you, I'm not content until I know which way you went. You got to have somewhere to go. Yeah. I had this man tell me, you know, when I die, I want a full open casket because I want everybody to see my alligator shoes. You're going to be all dressed up with nowhere to go. When you RSVP, God writes your name down in his guest book called the Book of Life. Listen to what Paul says in Ephesians 4, verse 3. He's talking about a group of women. He said, indeed, true companion, I ask you also to help these women who have shared my struggle in the cause of the gospel, together with Clement also and the rest of my fellow workers whose names are in the book of life. Jesus told his disciples and those of us who trust in him that he was going to heaven to prepare a place for them so that when they arrive, everything will be set. Although he was going to be crucified, although he was going to be raised from the dead, he was giving his life to save us, then he would go and get our place ready. How long does it take for y'all to get your house ready before you move into it? You know, just about a week or so, maybe a month. But let me tell you what Jesus did. Our cribs are going to be so awesome. Jesus has been working on it for 2,024 years. Imagine living down here versus living up there. This is a garbage dump down here compared to what we are in store for. And that he will get it ready because Jesus is the groom of the church and the church is his bride, and he will marry us together in heaven and we will be with him always. So on the way back to the Father, there's a sweet consolation, there's a great invitation, there's a personal preparation. Then lastly, there's an eternal elevation. Jesus said this, Pastor, Elder, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. Jesus knew very well that this life wasn't going to last because of the curse of sin that's upon it. He knew that heaven awaited those who placed their personal faith in him. He knew that in the meantime, we were just going to have a mean time. But he promised to come back and get us up out of here. That is a promise Jesus made to every believer. I'm coming back to get you. And so if Jesus promised to come back and get us and he came back and got Lorene Smith, what y'all mad about? He told her he was coming back anyway. Y'all forgot he said, I'm coming back to get you, to receive you unto myself. You know, I know y'all love these touchy-feely poems. It's like, I read this one poem one day that said, God looked around his garden and he recognized that he needed space. And there was a place where there was no flowers. So he looked down in heaven and he saw Lorene Smith and he wanted the best. Oh, that's a bunch of hogwash. Jesus said, I'm going to build something. I ain't got no garden for you. I'm going to build a place. And if I came the first time, I'm coming again. The first time I came to save you from sin. The next time I come, I'm saving you from this world so you can be with me in heaven. That's what the Bible says. Watch how the angels testified of this after Jesus rose from the dead in Acts chapter 1, verses 9 through 11. It says this, and after he had said these things, he was lifted up. This is Christ ascending into heaven. While they were looking on, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And as they were gazing intently into the sky while he was going, behold, two men, which were angels, in white clothing stood beside them. They also said, men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into the sky? This Jesus, whom has been taken up from you into heaven, will come in just the same way as you have watched him go into heaven. I'm here to remind some of you all and inform some of you all, Jesus is coming again. And when he comes again, he's coming to elevate those who has RSVP. They have graduated. He will come and help them ascend into heaven and take them away to be with him. When you die, you only go one or two places, up or down. You go up or down. And for some of y'all who said, well, I don't mind going to hell because, you know, when we get to hell, we're going to party. We're going to have a good time. Well, somebody sent notice back from hell saying all parties have been shut down due to fire. The Bible informs us that those who are saved will be with Jesus in one or two ways. First, we will die from some cause, and then he'll elevate us. There's like 15 ways, top ways that you can die. And I'm sorry, your preference probably won't happen. That of dying in your sleep of natural causes. How many of y'all know people who have died in their sleep of natural causes? You can probably count them on one hand. The rest of us died from, well, I ain't died yet, but the rest of them died from all kind of causes. You cannot prevent death. God says it's appointed unto man once to die, and after this comes the judgment. You die once, and you're judged once forever. This death angel was going toward this one man one day in a big crowd, like the Taste of Chicago, and he had this black robe on, had this sickle in his hand, and he's coming toward the guy, and the man sees death. And he runs, goes home, packs a suitcase, buys a ticket to Africa. He goes into the darkest part of the jungle in Africa, running away from death. And a man in the crowd saw that. And he walked up to death. He said, excuse me, death, I saw you was about to kill this man, and you let him go. Death took out his book and said, yeah, I rechecked my schedule. I'm supposed to kill him tomorrow night in the deepest, darkest part of the jungle in Africa. You are on God's schedule to die. That's the first way. God's going to take you up out of here through death. But the second way is the rapture. God says, those of us who are Christians, we're going to get caught up. Listen, y'all. I'm almost done. This is my first close. You know, preachers get three closes. This is my first close. Do y'all know why this alien thing is so big? It's been since the 1940s. They're talking about aliens and things like that. Because when we, as the people of God, disappear from this earth and get caught up and be changed and meet Jesus in the air, that's going to be the world's explanation. Aliens came and got these folk. Now, let me tell you, after the rapture, if you show up at church, you didn't make it. Churches that stay open after that, they didn't make it. Let me tell you what 1 Thessalonians 4, 14 through 17 says. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, them also which sleep in Jesus, that's Lorene Smith, will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord, that means he's coming again, shall not prevent them which sleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God. Watch this, y'all. And the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. That's the second way Jesus is coming back. For y'all don't believe it, you're going to be left here. And it can happen soon and very soon. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 51 through 52 says this. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall all be changed. Why do we have to have new bodies? Because these bodies we're in now have been tainted by sin. And God wants the bodies to be holy just like he is holy. See, that's why you can't, that's why you must be saved. You gotta be born again and have a new nature, because your nature right now is not compatible with heaven. Heaven is holy. God is holy. Can you imagine God allowing a thief to go to heaven? Nature ain't compatible. They walk up there like, ain't nothing to steal. For y'all that's involved in sexual sin without outside of marriage and doing all this other crazy stuff, if God let you up in heaven, you'd be looking for somebody to sleep with. Come on, your nature will stay the same. That's why you must be born again. You got to have a nature compatible with heaven. And you are born again. God gives you a new nature so that when you die, you don't have sin. You're standing before a holy God with a holy body, with a holy robe on, telling the story of how you made it over. But many of y'all in this sanctuary, y'all don't know nothing about that reality. If you were to die tonight, you already know within your heart that you're not ready to meet God. Jesus said in John 6, if you were to die, if you don't believe that I am he, you will die in your sins. I'm not here to judge anybody, because God has handed judgment over to his son. You can receive him as savior now or see him as judge later. God will not give you a chance to plead your case in heaven. Because I know some of y'all will get up there. See, what had happened was, you know, I had went over to Pookie's house and Shay Ray and them, they told me to do this. No, no, no. Everybody will give an account for their own sins. But if you don't know Jesus, your name is not written in the Lamb's Book of Life. As I close for the second time, Revelation 21 verse 15 says, and if anyone's name was not found written in the Book of Life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. come and go with Lorene to the Father's house. You can have sweet consolation in the midst of your troubles. Come and go with Lorene to the Father's house because you've been given a great invitation. Come and go with Lorene to the Father's house because Jesus is making a personal preparation for you. Come and go with me and Lorene to our Father's house because there's an eternal elevation. It's better up there than it is down here. Why do I say that? Because when you move into your new crib, into your new place, into your new mansion in heaven, God don't need none of the same furniture that you had down here. He don't need nobody to pave the streets because they're already paved with gold. Let me tell you what kind of furniture is not going to be there. In Revelation 21 verse 4 and 5, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. You can't take that furniture with you. And there shall be no more death. Can't take that furniture with you. Neither sorrow, can't take that with you, nor crying, nor shall there be any more pain. Why? For the former furniture, for the former things have passed away. And he that sat upon the throne says, behold, I am making all things new. And he said unto me, write, for these words are faithful and true. Let's give God a great hand clap of praise for his salvation through Jesus Christ. If you didn't understand how to get saved today, it is your fault that your soul will be lost. Lorene Smith took advantage of that early on in her life, and now she's in the presence of God, and she's waiting for those of us to come join her. Let me give you my third closing. A mother was lying in the hospital dying after completing a round of chemo. Nothing else could be done for her. And her family was standing around her. And as she was taking her last breath, she says, Bernice, I'll see you later. Bonita, I'll see you later. Beverly, I'll see you later. She turned to her son and said, Bernard, goodbye. And he said, wait a minute, Mama. What are you talking about telling my sisters you'll see them later and you telling me goodbye? She said, because they received Jesus Christ as their Savior like I did, and they're going to heaven like I'm going right now. You've never received Christ at all, so I have to tell you goodbye. And he said, Mama, I don't want you to say goodbye to me. She said, then receive Christ as your Savior. Bernard bowed his head right there and he said, Jesus, save me from my sins and give me eternal life and let me live with you forever so that I could go to be with my mother and with you for all of eternity. Today, did Lorene Smith say goodbye to anybody or see you later? Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your Holy Spirit, which speaks through your word. I pray that these individuals have heard from your heart, and they will point the finger like Lorene Smith often did and say, you told the truth, that was right. And I pray that they would turn their lives over to you, to walk with you, to open up a Bible, to join a church, and come to know you as their Lord and Savior. Now, God, continue to be with this family as they walk through the valley of the shadow of death, because weeping may endure for a night, but you promised them that joy will come in the morning. It is in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. I'm going to ask that the directors will come at this time and give us final instructions. We're going to need at least three individuals to bear the flowers. And as they're coming, is there one in the crowd understood exactly what was being said to you? And just raise your hand and just show by raising of the hand, I want to give my life to Jesus. God bless you all. Thank you. Don't just raise your hand, but give your life over to him. He loves you so much. He died for you, and he wants you to have a relationship with him. You may stand. In Revelation verses 9 through 17 of the seventh chapter, it says, after these things, I looked and behold, a great multitude which no one could count, from every nation and all tribes and peoples and tongues, standing before the throne, before the Lamb, clothed in white robes, and palm branches were in their hands. And they cried out with a loud voice, saying, "Salvation to our God who sits on the throne." Salvation to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb of God. And all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. And they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, "Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders answered, saying to me, "These who are clothed in white robes, who are they, and where have they come from?" I said to him, "My Lord, you know." And he said to me, "These are the ones who come out of great tribulation, and they have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason, they are before the throne of God, and they serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will spread his tabernacle over them. They will hunger no more, nor thirst any more, nor will the sun beat down on them, nor any heat. For the Lamb in the center of the throne will be their shepherd and will guide them to springs of the water of life. And God will wipe every tear away from their eyes. Amen." Have your attention, please, as we're about to commence the interment part of our service. Let's start with prayer. Let's pray. God, our Father, we thank you for an opportunity to witness the depositing of our dear sister Lorene Smith, body into the ground as a seed that you will watch over until the day of resurrection, and you would resurrect her into a most glorious resurrected flower where she would be able to abide with you forever. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
We have come to the final earthly resting place of our dear sister, Lorene Smith. God has chosen to take away what he freely loaned to us in her life. The fond memories that linger in our hearts should be cherished as a gift from the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. For as much as it has pleased Almighty God in his wise providence to take out of this world the soul of our dear sister, Lorene Smith, we therefore commit her body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, looking for the general resurrection in the last day and the life of the world to come through our Lord Jesus Christ. To him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to make you stand in the presence of his glory with great joy. To the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, now and forever. Everyone said, amen.
Amen.
Amen.